At the heart of the 5G debate are radio altimeters. A radio altimeter measures the aircraft's altitude, how high the aircraft is from the ground. They also provide data for safety and navigation systems. In early 2020, out of the abundance of caution, the Federal Aviation Administration, or FAA, issued a safety alert about high-powered 5G towers interfering with radio altimeters installed on aircraft. Pilots were asked to pay attention to their gauges. If the radio altimeters were to stop working properly due to interference and provide pilots and systems with incorrect data, the results could be disastrous during the landing phase of a flight. But is there any evidence for this? Sort of, as the FAA has based the entire dispute on a theoretical modeling of multiple worst-case scenarios with obsolete altimeters. The Radio Technical Commission for Aeronautics, or RTCA, an American organization which produces technical guidance on aviation modernization issues, produced a report. In its report, it warned that 5G poses a major risk to commercial aircraft under certain conditions. The report warned of the possibility of, quote, catastrophic failure leading to multiple fatalities in the absence of appropriate mitigations, unquote. But the critics say that no tests were done on the 5G network or on actual equipment used in modern aircraft when RTCA reached their conclusion. They just used models. Call me a simple man, but models can be quite convincing. As an interim solution, the FAA allowed airplanes with accurate, reliable altimeters to operate around high-powered 5G antennas. However, airplanes with older altimeters will not be allowed to use radio altimeters close to the 5G antennas. And this is an issue, because under low visibility conditions, aircraft cannot land safely without the use of altimeters. Effectively, this would ground the majority of the US fleet of commercial airplanes during bad weather. As of January 16, 2022, during low visibility conditions, only 45% of the commercial airplanes in the US were certified to land at airports that have 5G towers. AT&T and Verizon were scheduled to turn on their new 5G networks on January 19, 2022, but this would effectively cause a massive disruption in the US, since most aircraft would essentially not be allowed to operate during poor weather conditions. Even worse, because radio altimeters provide critical data to other safety and navigation systems, the rollout of 5G would ground many aircraft indefinitely. For this reason, CEOs of many airlines in the US asked the government to prevent the rollout of 5G within 2 miles of airport runways. But the puck didn't stop there. On January 19, 2022, Emirates announced that due to operational concerns associated with the planned deployment of 5G mobile network services in the US at certain airports, it would stop flying to some US airports. And soon, many other airlines followed suit. So again, just to make it clear, the issue is not the actual 5G interference per se, but an FAA regulation which prohibits the operation of many aircraft under certain conditions, like bad weather when around 5G towers. This regulation is in place by the FAA to make sure 5G is safe to operate near airports. If you're thinking, hold on a second, I already have 5G on my phone and I'm actually inside an airplane right now. What's up with that? You are correct. 5G is already deployed in most airports. Now, I fly a lot, so during my travels, I've been able to help discover 5G spots right in the airport, and those people have never been happier. What? I help people discover them. You know, those spots that have 5G coverage in the airport? 5G spots? But not all 5G has been created equally. Let me elaborate. 5G is a next-generation mobile internet connection which was launched in the US in April of 2019. The biggest benefits of 5G are increased download and upload speed as well as low latency. and this is deemed to be disruptive to wireline technologies, as 5G is more economical to deploy compared to DSL, cable, or even fiber. 5G has a theoretical maximum speed of 20 gigabits per second, while 4G is only 1 gigabit per second. But here is where it gets complicated. Now, you may think you have 5G, but in reality, you have fake G, meaning that your speed and latency are virtually indistinguishable from 4G. And that's because 5G can operate in three ranges of radio signals: low, mid, and high band frequencies. Each band of frequencies has advantages and disadvantages. The low band frequencies, the frequencies that are used by analog TV broadcast stations, provide superior geographical coverage. One low band tower can cover hundreds of square miles with 5G service, with speeds ranging from 30 to 250 megabits. Additionally, low band frequencies work well when trying to get a signal inside buildings. The disadvantage is that the latency and speed are nowhere near the hyped-up 5G that's been advertised. In fact, for the end user, low-band 5G is virtually indistinguishable from 4G. The mid-band frequencies range from 2 GHz to 6 GHz. Many consider 5G in mid-band to be the minimum performance tier, as it's noticeably faster than 4G. Of course, those who are marketing it would stick a 5G label on anything, like they do on the low-band 5G. The mid-band offers speeds of up to 10 times faster than 4G, as you can see in the tests performed by the U.S. Department of Defense. The downside of mid-band 5G is decreased coverage area when compared to low-band 5G. Each mid-band tower can provide coverage of up to several miles in radius. AT&T and Verizon deployed their mid-band 5G network on January 19, 2022 to 90 million customers. And it's this mid-band 5G network which is intertwined with the radio altimeter controversy. Finally, high-band 5G uses frequencies in the range of 24 to 47 GHz, also known as millimeter waves. High-band 5G, also known as true 5G, provides speeds of up to 20 times faster than 4G and has significantly lower latency. Tests performed by the U.S. Department of Defense showed that high-band 5G is just slightly faster than the mid-band 5G, but offers one-third of the latency. Additional tests where high-band 5G was used in conjunction with mid-band and multiple inputs produced about 2.5 times higher speeds than mid-band or high-band 5G alone. The true 5G was marketed to be a true game-changer, enabling things such as self-driving cars communicating with each other and so on due to low latency. But it's increasingly becoming obvious that true 5G is impractical due to its poor coverage of just 0.7 miles from the tower and its inability to penetrate, something that both 5G and I struggle with. Most telecom carriers scaled down their true 5G networks for this very reason. Traditionally, whenever a new wireless technology is launched in the US, be it 3G, 4G, or 5G, the Federal Communications Commission, or FCC, works hand in hand with FAA and other stakeholders. A few years back, the FCC decided that mid-band 5G will use the C-band portion of the frequency spectrum in the United States. Auctions were held, and the rights to the wavelengths were sold to telecom companies. For instance, Verizon paid $45.5 billion for the rights, while it only cost them a few billion dollars to build the actual mid-band network. The C-band label in the United States refers to the frequencies in the range of 3.7 to 4.2 GHz. This is just on the edge of frequencies used by airplanes' radio altimeters, which use 4.2 to 4.4 GHz frequencies. Radio altimeter frequencies are universally adopted around the world. Aviation industry asked for a 100 MHz guard band to be put in place, but they got double that, as mid-band 5G networks in the US operate from 3.7 to 3.98 GHz. Economists and spectrum experts have expressed that a 220 MHz guard band is excessive. Interestingly, satellites use 4 to 4.2 GHz with a 20 MHz guard band in place. So how that doesn't interfere with radio altimeters is interesting. Maybe they are lower powered. But what about all the other countries that have deployed 5G connection without any harm to aircraft operations? It is estimated that nearly 40 countries around the world have built 5G networks. But as I mentioned previously, it is only the mid-band networks that can potentially interfere with avionics. Countries that only have low-band 5G networks, like Canada, wouldn't experience any interference with radio altimeters. But then, there are countries that have mid-band networks without any issues, such as the UK, France, and Japan, to name a few. However, three things make American 5G deployment different from other countries. Number one, the US mid-band 5G networks operate at frequencies much closer to the one that radio altimeters use. For comparison, the UK uses the 3.4 to 3.8 GHz spectrum, and Canada is planning to operate 5G networks below 3.7 GHz, which means a lower probability of interference. Number two, American towers emit much more powerful signal strengths than those in the other countries. European towers operate at lower power, which further reduces risks. And number three, American antennas point at a higher angle. But despite all these differences, it's worthwhile to take a look at how France handled this situation. When the concerns about 5G and radio altimeters first surfaced, France acted immediately by setting a testing plan, performing tests, and subsequently developing permanent mitigation strategies near airports. Within weeks, permanent measures had been put in place, which included a 96-second flight time buffer zone around airports. In these buffer zones, the 5G antennas are tilted downward to reduce potential interference with airplanes that are landing. In addition to that, the placement of 5G towers carefully takes into account the runways. And finally, the power level of the antennas were reduced. And despite having to implement all these mitigation measures, the 5G rollout in France remained on schedule and with no harm to the aircraft in the sky. Voila! Japan is also an interesting case, because their 5G frequency range goes from 3.6 to 4.2 GHz, which is just outside of the frequencies of radio altimeters, 4.2 to 4.4 GHz. Also keep in mind that Japan has a much denser 5G network than the US will ever have. And yet, they report no issues whatsoever. Well, except for the occasional Godzilla attacks. Regulators, the aviation industry, and telecom companies had years to deal with concerns around 5G and altimeter interference. What some countries like France figured out in weeks is taking years to do in the United States with no clear end in sight. Tim Clark, the president of Emirates, called the whole situation one of the most delinquent, utterly irresponsible situations he'd ever seen. Which makes me think Mr. Clark must not have seen this chicken sandwich served by his own airline. There's the chicken. As the FCC is nudging the FAA to conduct safety checks with both care and speed, the FAA, which had years to clear airplanes, is now doing it in a matter of days. We're not saying the FAA is not doing a fine job, but when you do things last minute, sometimes quality deteriorates. On January 25, 2022, the FAA issued an airworthiness directive that prohibits 747s and 777s from landing at airports where 5G interference could occur. The US wireless industry body, CTIA, accused the aviation industry of scaremongering and warned that delaying the introduction of 5G would cause economic harm. Telecom industry has already postponed its 5G rollout, twice. Current delays are estimated to affect about 10% of the 5G towers, as the telecom industry conceded to create 50 temporary buffer zones around airports. There is no C-band 5G transmission in these buffer zones, which provides airplanes with 20 seconds of signal-free time when they come in for landing. and this will buy the FAA 6 months to certify the remaining airplanes and make sure they can safely land during low visibility conditions while using radio altimeters. The FAA should never compromise safety, but this problem was their own making, reaching a point where commercial aviation could have come to a complete halt. The airlines in the US are arguably not too afraid of the new 5G rollout, but more concerned with how the FAA is addressing it. By the way, we're very excited to have our first live Q&A session with you, our loyal audience, on February 1st, 2022 at 5 p.m. Eastern Time. Join our Discord server and sign up for the event. Check out the link in the description.